François-Philippe Champagne.
François-Philippe Champagne. Hello. Hello. Thank you for having me, Esther. It's a great pleasure to have you with us today. We know you as a minister, but less as a person. You were born on Montreal's South Shore. You grew up in Mauricie. Tell us about your childhood. What were the dominant values at home? Well, it's always been a well-kept secret. In my passport, it says Greenfield Park. When the journalists saw that, they said, you're not from Mauricie. I said, well, my mother gave birth at Charlemagne Hospital. But we never really lived there. I don't remember having lived in Longueuil, despite the fact that the mayor of Longueuil asked me to come home. That was local pride. She was very nice. And here's part of my life that not many people know about. I really grew up in Quebec City when I was young. I lived with my mother. My parents were divorced. They divorced in the 70s. I lived with my mother mainly until I was about 15 or 16. After that, I went back to Mauricie to live with my father. That's when I went to college, elementary school and high school. Well, most of that was done in Quebec City. I went back to Mauricie on the weekends. There wasn't shared custody. You lived either with one parent or the other, and sometimes you would see the other parent on the weekend. So I'd go to Mauricie on the weekends, but I went to school in Quebec City. That's why I have a strong feeling of attachment to Mauricie. It's the region I represent, but I know Quebec City very well because that's where I started my education. What did your mother do in Quebec City? She was a provincial public servant, quite a challenge. She was a single mother in those days. I was born in the 1970s. Do you have a brother? My father remarried, so I have a half-brother, half-sister. I don't think we call them like that today. So my father got married later. But there's a good 10 years between us. So my youth was like this. But when I returned to Mauricie, I became very close to my brothers and sisters. That's part of my life that people don't know about. You're an only son, right? Yes, I am. And your father was a businessman in Mauricie, right? That's right. Very well known. He was a builder. That generation of baby boomers who started out with very little. My father was from a family of 13. My grandmother on my father's side. Well, think about it. She had 13 children. Some died young, of course. But on top of that, she ran the convenience store and the factory cafeteria. So she cooked for her own family, but also all the workers in the region. When I look at my grandmother's stories and I see the photos of her and the era, it's really Quebec as it was in the industrial area. My grandmother, my mother, they had a very heavy workload. That's how they survived. And what did your father do? He was a businessman, an entrepreneur, a builder. He was really of the generation, a baby boomer. He was a lawyer by training. He'd studied at the Quebec City Chamber of Commerce. And then he'd started many businesses. He was able to make any situation into a profitable one. He'd always impressed me. He wasn't an engineer. He wasn't a mathematician. He wasn't an accountant. He was a lawyer. But he had flair. He had a nose for business. He was able to turn things around, to go out and get funding, and to build flourishing companies that employ many people and support many families. You studied law at the University de Montréal. Then you went abroad to study. Why did you decide to leave Canada? I'd always wanted to leave and then come back when I was young. I knew that if you look at the graduation book, there was a note saying that François-Philippe Champagne wants to go into politics. But I was attracted by international law as well, so I thought it was worth going abroad. I studied at the University of Montreal. It was the start of NAFTA.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you. And may God bless you all.
We were starting to look at the U.S. But there were many lawyers in Quebec and Canada who really knew American law. That was at the time when there was no internet. There were posts at the university. I clipped one of the coupons off. I applied for a job. I went and got a $50 money order. I sent in my application. My grades were average. A month and a half later, I received a reply saying I'd been accepted. I was incredulous. I called. I said, "Are you sure you didn't make a mistake?" He said, "Look, we're very, very serious." So I did the course, and at the end, when I got my diploma, I went to see the dean of the faculty, and I said, "Look, there's still a big mystery in my head. Why did you admit me to your university program in the U.S.?" He said, "Look, do you want to know the truth?" I said, "Yes, I do." It was the first year that we'd opened our program to foreign students, and you're the only Canadian who'd applied. So sometimes in life, luck smiles on you. It was pure luck. It was pure luck. You also practiced law in Italy, in Rome, in fact. That's something we know less about you. You speak fluent Italian, right? Well, that's part of life. Life is like a pyramid. You need skills, you need healthy ambition, a lot of luck as well. When I was studying at the American University, my classmate, we had desks together, was an Italian. And he said, after we graduated, "What are you doing now? Are you looking for a job?" I said, "Well, I don't have any plans. I was 24 or 23. He said, "Would you like to come and work with us?" And that's how I ended up in Italy, in Genoa, not in Rome, but in Genoa, in Liguria, near the Mediterranean coast. It was interesting at the time. It was an adventure. It was supposed to last a year. I was there for 5 years. I'm called Champagne. There's not much Italian blood in my family, so I learned Italian on the job. Never went to school, but at 53, I'm still able to speak it fluently. It was probably out of necessity, because back then in Italy, there weren't many foreigners. I was the only foreigner. Imagine what I looked like at 24. I wasn't any taller. So when I arrived, my office was on the top floor. I remember that I pressed the button for the ninth floor, and a lady said, "Well, it's great that you've come to visit your father." I said, "No, my father doesn't live here, he doesn't work here." He said, "Haven't you come to visit your mother?" "No, no, no, my mother's in Quebec City." "Well, what are you doing?" "I work on the ninth floor." It was at a time when there were very few foreigners and very few young people. It also helped me to get a better appreciation of those who chose to come to Canada. I lived in Italy, Switzerland, and in England as well, in very different conditions to those who come to Canada. But that allowed me to understand what it was like to have to adapt, to have to learn, to have to build a new life, because I arrived there alone. Of course, when I look back, it brings a smile to my face. You know, going back to Italy at 50, it's not the same thing as it was at 20. Very different. So you came back to Quebec in 2014 to run for election in Shawinigan in 2015, right? My team and I are ready to bring change on the 19th of October. It's time to change together. Thank you very much. You said earlier that you've always wanted to do politics, get into politics. But what pushed you to run at that point? Well, I've always thought that when you're too comfortable, it's time to change. I was 40. I thought if I don't take the plunge now, life might take me somewhere else. You're right. It was very, very comfortable. So every time I got comfortable, I decided to change, to do different things. It was a time in my life when I thought it's time to do it now or never. Moving from London to Shawinigan, well, it was quite a change. It was a former prime minister's riding, of course. You have to remember the Liberal Party had been elected there since Mr. Chrétien. But I was campaigning in Latuk one day. As you know, my riding is bigger than Belgium, to put everything into perspective. 8-hour drive north to south. Remember, I was in a restaurant. It was in 2013, 2 years before the election. And I was told that I had to go and shake hands. I was in a pizzeria midday in Latuk, and I was going about saying, "I'm François-Philippe Champagne, I'm running in the federal election." And people were saying, "Well, there's no election." I said, "Well, there will be an election soon." So I campaigned for 2 years on a part-time basis. That was in 2013. That's right. So I was already starting to campaign at that point. 2 years of campaigning, because it's a big riding, taught me to be humble. What's important is humility. It's not what you've done or your experience or what you've done professionally. It's what you're going to do for people. And that's what drove me. I'm very close to people. Very often when I'm doing my grocery shopping, people stop me and people say, "You're like the village priest." And people come to talk to me about all sorts of things. I'm very close to people. It's important for me. And it's what keeps me going. Back to the moon. Well, this energy comes from people. People who keep me going. When you came back to Shawinigan, you got together with your first love, Anne-Marie, who's now your partner. Tell us a bit about her. She was my first girlfriend, as we used to say. She wasn't my spouse. We were in high school, 15, 16 years old. We'd lost touch for about 30 years. She was living her own life. She had two daughters. So we saw each other again at some point. We've been together for 10 years. I'm the stepfather to two grown daughters, 17 and 19, one who's studying here at the University of Ottawa. So it's a lovely story. We met young. I left for Europe. She lived her life. And then we met up again after 30 years. 30 years later, an interesting family dynamic. She spends more time in Quebec City. I'm here during the week. Shawinigan's our base. A lot of driving, right? Well, that's the way it is. We're experts in family logistics. Do you find it difficult? Yes, I do. Politics is intoxicating. I love it. But what's the hardest thing is to reconcile that with family life. You're never there. I'm never at home. I'm never at home by default. When Parliament isn't sitting, that's when I'm traveling. When you're a federal minister, I'm traveling across Canada. I'm traveling to Quebec City, to Saskatoon. People want me to come more. When I'm in the Maritimes, people say, "You haven't been here for a long time." It's constant. And I would say that that's the biggest price you have to pay. It's your family that pays the price. It's the spouses that pay the price. We live in a time where we're asked a lot of our elected reps at the municipal level, provincially, federally. When I look at my colleagues, when I look at people, I have to say that they give a lot. They have passion for public service. But the hardest part, Ms. Bégin, is not being able to be with your family. How do you remain connected to your family even if you're not there? Do you feel guilty? Oh, I do. Of course I do. It's difficult to reconcile both. We always try to do better. I'm lucky. I can drive to my home in Mauricie, but think about my colleagues from the Atlantic or Northern Canada, the West Coast. There's a high price to pay. Politics, as you know when it starts, you never know when it ends. Family is everyone's anchor, right? And I hope that one day we'll be able to make changes for the next generations. You know, we're trying to attract more young women into politics, more young people. I think that one day we're going to have to find a way to adapt, right? It's an institution with long traditions, of course. But I think if we want to modernize, we're going to have to think along these lines. I think the younger generation sees things very differently. They operate in a different way, right? Institutions are rooted in the past, in traditions that were perhaps once fashionable, in line with people's way of life, but things have to change. The fact that we sit 5 days a week, for example, that has to change. Now we have a mobile application that allows people to vote, even if you're on the road. That's an improvement. If we want to attract young mothers, young fathers, we're going to have to think about how Parliament can reconcile those two situations. You talked about your good friend and mentor, Mr. Chrétien. Talk to us a bit about Jean Chrétien's impact on your career.
Well,
I had the privilege to get to know him when I was a young man. He's a larger-than-life man. He's 90, and he's still continuing to connect with people.
avec les gens.
Je pourrais rester jusqu'à demain matin, là.
I could stay till tomorrow if you like.
Que vous avez aussi.
You have that, right? I don't know if there's something in the water in Shawinigan. Brings us closer to people. You're still in pretty good shape. Well, look, it's because I drink water from Lac des Piles, like you do, right? There's something in the water in Shawinigan. When I was young, he invited me. Ms. Chrétien, Aline would take care of those things. He invited me to a dinner party in Germany. I think it was in Munich, and I remember he invited me. It wasn't with the chancellor, but the leader of the region where we were. It was an official dinner, so imagine the protocol. I was right at the end of the table. I was about 30, and Mr. Chrétien said, no, I want champagne next to me. He called you champagne. He said, come and sit here. So I had Mr. Chrétien, Ms. Chrétien, and then me, and the other German was looking over thinking, who the heck is he? The Prime Minister of Canada, Jean Chrétien. Thank you, everyone. Mr. Chrétien has always had a way of really showing off our people. We represent the same riding. But I've always been there for local people. He was. I remember now another anecdote. People say I have energy. And one day I was out walking with Mr. Chrétien Shawinigan. Mr. Chrétien said, hi, I'm Jean Chrétien. And people think, is this really Mr. Chrétien? Everyone recognizes Mr. Chrétien. 99.9% of people know who he is. And I've always said that to politicians. Don't assume that people recognize you. That's always been a sign of humility from Mr. Chrétien. He's always said, hello, my name is Jean Chrétien. We've kept this closeness. He's been around for decades. He's seen the world change. Ms. Chrétien learned Italian, perhaps because I used to sit, that's why he put me next to her very often. A very special relationship. I feel privileged. There's something that brings us together. You're still very close then. Oh, yes, we are. Even Mr. Chrétien texts now. Imagine, sometimes he calls me, he says, what are you doing? And I say, okay, I'll come over. I know he wants to see me. He comes to my house, I go to his house. That's the dynamic between us. It's a great privilege to be able to rub shoulders with someone like him, who has seen a lot and gives back. He does it with me, does it with my colleagues as well. He's very generous with his time, with his knowledge. Sometimes we have very heated exchanges. Well, things have changed. The way politics is done has changed. The way election campaigns is run has changed. A lot of digital today. The media are vital in reaching out to citizens. It's more than a friendship. It's more like complicity. I think we have great complicity.
Vous êtes entré au cabinet en 2017.
You joined cabinet in 2017. Then you've held most of the most important departments. Where'd you get your energy? I've read that you do yoga, among other things, but that's new. This is new in your 50s. It's a job that requires a lot of energy. You have to have that energy. You have to have healthy lifestyle habits as well. I started out in one department, and then I moved to several others. I don't know how many I've actually been minister of, about 10. When my first role was parliamentary secretary, the Minister of Finance, I remember Mr. Chrétien. Mr. Chrétien at the time said that this was a good way to start, because I was able to see how a budget is developed over 2 years. It gives you a good understanding of the government machine. There's no course, there's no training when you arrive in Ottawa. But my experience really helped me, because when you've been when you've worked in more than one department, you have perspective. You get the big picture. So when someone tells me it's not possible, I say, well, we did it this way in another department. It's an undeniable advantage. You know, in big departments, there's one way of doing things. And very often I say, no, we can do things differently. It served me well. This energy is important, I think. People often say, Well, what do you do? Why do you do this? Well, I always say when I get up in the morning, I'm very, very happy. And I've always said that a country can never be more optimistic than its leaders. So I think we have a role to play in energizing and providing an optimistic vision of the future. There are challenges, there are issues, but if you look at modern Canada, we're all privileged to live in a country that inspires internationally. Do you have time for leisure activities? Not really. If you were to ask my spouse, she'd say you should have more hobbies. It's a demanding job. I like to do exercise, but I've resigned myself to not being able to do everything. I can only do things that I can do alone, running, yoga. I like team sports. I like jogging because it's easy. I can do it when I can, not always when I want, of course. You know, for me, when we might get together with my family, we often go out into the water on the Mauricie River. Do you have a boat? Yes, I have a boat. It allows me to connect. We're lucky we're in Mauricie, right in the heart of the national park. I need that. I understand why people feel good when they're out in the woods. It's great when you're in nature. It brings you back to the essence of life. So it's a need for you to reconnect with nature, right? I'm very sociable, but sometimes it's good to take the time to read, to be alone. You have to be able to recharge your batteries. You can't always be running at 100 kilometers an hour. Sometimes you have to look for perspective. You have to take a step back and then look ahead. You know, taking a step back has enabled me to learn a different language, experience new things. We need difference within a political team. We need different types of experiences and visions of what Canada can be. Your detractors say you talk too much, that you're verbose. How do you respond to those criticisms? So, well, look, they're always talking to me. They can't be that bad. It's part of our role as politicians. To talk to journalists, to answer their questions. It's a part of democracy. What we're currently doing is part of democracy. We're talking about ideas. And what I like also is that we're often seen as politicians, but seeing that behind the politician, there's a man and a woman. When I'm doing my grocery shopping, people in the Mauricie know that I do that. But when I'm elsewhere, people are surprised. You know, when I'm out with my daughter, we also have to show that side to people because we're above all there to serve citizens. You like talking? Well, people stop me wherever I go. Perhaps I'm verbose, perhaps I speak a lot, but after 10 years, people recognize me across the country. I'm pretty used to being able to interact, and I like it, to be honest with you. I like talking to people. And I like talking about different things. You're not trying to fix that and trying to change it. For as long as people want to talk to me, I'll continue to talk to them. When you're a member of parliament for a rural riding, you're very close to people, you're in touch, and it's good. It's a good thing, I think. In 2023, your government announced major investments in the battery industry. What's the next big thing in Canada, in your opinion? You're right, the battery industry was a dream come true in the space of a few months. When I started, we were talking about, we're talking here about the first meetings I had with my public servants at the Ministry of Industry. I said, no, we're going through one of the most dramatic periods in our history. It's a great transformation. We're moving from the gas engine to the electric motor. It's an opportunity. That's the next big thing. People have to realize that, according to Bloomberg, we've become the world leader ahead of the Chinese in the battery sector. It's Bloomberg that says that. We've attracted record investment. We seized an opportunity because we knew that the sector was going to grow, and we got some of that investment here. Now, artificial intelligence, I was recently talking to a pioneer in this technology, and I told him that at 53, one of the great technological revolutions of our generation was the Internet. I'm of the generation that discovered the Internet. For young people, it's amazing to think that the Internet didn't exist when we were young. Well, if you ask my daughters, sometimes they wonder how we did things. We went to the library and you looked it up, quite simply. And one of the things I asked one of the pioneers, I was talking about the president of NVIDIA, And I said, how would you compare the Internet to artificial intelligence? And he took a moment, he thought about it, and he said, Minister, the potential is 1,000 times greater. So that evening, I came back home and I said, well, let's imagine that he's wrong by 90%. He's 90% out. Artificial intelligence could have a potential that's 10 times greater than that of the Internet to transform our society. So that digital revolution will have an impact. I don't think we're able, you and me today, to visualize and understand the impact over the next 20 and 30 years. I often say that humans are capable of linear thinking, but the way our brains work, we have trouble thinking exponentially. When you're talking about technology, revolutionary technology like the Internet was at the time, like artificial intelligence will be, like quantum physics will be as well, you have to think exponentially. The cell phones were part of everyday life when I was young. They're an essential tool today. It's hard to imagine what impact this technology will have. I think we have to move from fear to opportunity. And for that, we need a regulatory framework. We have to reestablish trust, because people listening to us tonight will say, yes, but, and I understand that, I have the same concerns. That's why we're trying to develop a regulatory framework. And Canada is really a leader in what we call responsible artificial intelligence, the service of people, the service of humanity. You know that many see you as the leader of the Liberal Party of Canada in the future if Mr. Trudeau decides to step down. Would you be tempted or interested? Mr. Trudeau has made it clear that he'll be the leader of the Liberal Party in the next election, and that's a very good thing, I think. But if ever Mr. Trudeau took his walk in the snow and decided to leave, would you be interested in replacing him? Would you run? But I think it's been made clear. There's no walking, there's no snow. So that question is settled. The Prime Minister of Canada, Mr. Trudeau, will be here for the next election. Politics is a team sport. You win as a team or you lose as a team. And you always have to remember that. People will be watching to see which team can continue to modernize Canada. And my role is often to raise the level of ambition, to seize opportunities, to tell the Canadian story. There aren't many people in the world who get up in the morning thinking about Canada. Do you think Canada has lost its relevance on the international stage today? Well, it's a complex world. But Canada, I think, remains the voice that people want to hear. I was Minister of Foreign Affairs, and I'm still working internationally today. I'll give you an example. In the area of artificial intelligence, when we were called by the British Prime Minister to take part in that great meeting at Bletchley Park, where they decoded the famous German code during the Second World War, an emblematic place. Canada was one of the big players. I was co-chair with Joshua Bengio, who's one of the fathers of AI, and everyone recognizes Canada's scientific contribution. Others see you as leader of the Quebec Liberal Party. Obviously, the position is open. Could you make the leap to provincial politics, do you think? Is that possible for you? Well, this, I have a seat here in Ottawa, and I like that. No. No, I'm here. I'm in Ottawa. I'm very humble about this. There are people who inspire me. Well, basically, what we're doing is moving Quebec forward. I've always said that I'll be a candidate in the next election for the Liberal Party. I've been clear on that. And I'm happy to be able to serve the interests of Quebec while being in federal politics. Well, life is long. It's clear that I've told everyone that I'll be running in the upcoming federal election. And I think I've got a pretty full schedule. I'm not looking for another job. Sometimes I wonder how I'm going to do everything, but I have a job, a lot of things I still want to do, and things are going well. I appreciate everyone trying to help me find another job. Thank you. Perhaps one day I'll be a TV host. Perhaps we'll do TV together one day. Be a pleasure. Everything's possible. François-Philippe Champagne, we'll keep an eye on you. Thanks very much. Thank you very much for having me on your show. It's a great pleasure. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.